Aye. November 14th, 1994, 7:30 p.m. We'll have a roll call.
Chairman Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor Chapel?
Yeah.
Counselor Cogswell?
Here.
Counselor Dahlbeck?
Here.
Counselor Linnell?
Here.
Counselor Marvin?
Here.
And Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
Thank you. Will you all please rise and we salute the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Minutes of the meeting of 5-94-95, held October 12, 1994. What is your wishes for the council?
Move approval of the minutes.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment? Ready for the vote? All in favor, raise your right hand. Thank you. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Anybody, member of the council, have anything they'd like to bring up that isn't on our agenda tonight? Yes, no?
I'm not ready.
Oh, you're not ready?
She's waiting for reports and correspondence.
Yes, thank you.
Moving on then, of reports and correspondence. Anybody have any reports? Yes, sir. Counselor Chapel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Regional Waste Services, they had a Finance Committee meeting on November 3rd. Take up 5-year capital improvement program so we can get it in the budget every year and not be surprised anything happening all at once. November the 9th, there was a 4 p.m. Executive Committee meeting on the same subject, and then this Thursday at 5 p.m. Executive Committee and 7 p.m. Board meeting when we make a decision, and I'll report to you on it in December. A note of interest to Cape Elizabeth people, residents, and taxpayers. Over at the Community Center at the present time, there's an art show with 24 artists from Cape Elizabeth showing their paintings, and it's open tonight from 5 to 8. I don't expect any of you to get up and run right over. Tomorrow from noon to 3, Friday from 1 to 4, and Saturday from 1 to 4. It's a great little show, and I think you'd be interested where it's 24 artists from Cape Elizabeth. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Counselor Dahlbeck.
I would just like to add on to that that the paintings of Grandpa Moses' chapel are excellent in the exhibit.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor McGlough.
They're always such a hard act to follow, I'm telling you. A number of things. The Casco Bay Estuary Project is holding a public forum this Saturday from 10 a.m. to noontime at the Sonesta Hotel on High Street in Portland. They are developing the Casco Bay Plan, which is the purpose of which is to protect the ecological health of the bay and its watershed. I was at a meeting for staff members in my planning position recently and was very impressed with the work that is done. There's some mapping work that's absolutely fantastic if anybody's into maps, and also some very good discussion. I encourage any citizens who are interested in the bay and in ecological matters to attend that this Saturday. It's again 10 to 12 at the Sonesta Hotel. Another happening recently, I'm hoping Councillor Linnell made a photo opportunity last Thursday morning. I totally forgot about. But there's a new rideshare program. Some of the councillors have said, well, how does that differ from carpooling? It does not differ from carpooling. But I've had occasion recently to be in other states in the Eastern Seaboard, and they also have the rideshare signs up. So it might be a federal moniker. I don't know. But one of the services that rideshare is now interested in offering is carpooling for people traveling to meetings together, be those meetings in Portland, Brunswick, Augusta, or Lewiston. There's an 800 number for that. It's 1-800-280, then RIDE. I don't know what those numbers are, but that's another service being offered at this time, which for anybody who has meetings in Augusta occasionally might be worth looking into. I think it's well worth knowing about. The Executive Committee of GP Cog will be meeting this Wednesday, the night after tomorrow, 5 to 7, at the GP Cog offices. An interesting panel will be held that evening. It's entitled, "How Do You Look to Your Taxpayer Customer Service?" I encourage any counselors who are interested to attend that with me. Also, would like to thank counselors, Mr. McGovern, our manager, and I believe Bob Malley, our Public Works Director, who are in attendance at the GP Cog 25th anniversary celebration last month. That was chaired by Jane Amaro and Penny Carson, two former Cape counselors and former presidents of GP Cog. We had a pleasant evening. I think there were some winners in the trivia contest from among this group. Councilor Cogswell and Councilor Jordan, I believe, are at the winning table. Took home some loot with them. Also, in my capacity as chairman of the Appointments Committee, I would like to encourage members of the public who reside in Cape Elizabeth to consider running, making out applications for our boards and commissions. Councilor Linnell was good enough to assist by having a very nice poster about that, and as well as his presence at the polls last week. The deadline is fast upon us, being tomorrow, but we are known to be flexible. We're especially in need right now, I believe, of members for our Family Fun Day committee. I think a lot of people know what a good time they have and enjoy that Family Entertainment Day at Fort Williams in June. If that's going to come off, we need some good people to be on the organization end of that. So I encourage you to consider applying to be on that board. I would also like to commend the town clerk, Deborah Lane, for running a very smooth election last week. Job well done. And congratulate our new state representative, Gene Marvin. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. Anybody else? Any comment? Moving on, we're going to have a public hearing on the amendments to the zoning and boards and commission ordinance, associate members of the Planning Board and Zoning Board. And I believe, Councilor McLaughlin, you are going to...
Sure. She's on a roll. This is something I brought to the Council's attention last month. It is a product of the report of the Land Use Regulation Process Review Committee. I mean, that was the LURP, and we were starting to have those names. Recommendation from that committee was that the Planning Board and the Board of Zoning Appeals eliminate the position of associate member, and rather than have five regular members and two associate members on each of those boards, we have seven regular members. So the two associate positions would become regular member positions. We discussed this fairly briefly but thoroughly, I believe, last month. In conjunction with this is the proposal to have Planning Board members, Board of Zoning Appeals members, and Conservation Commission members be able to serve for three consecutive three-year terms. Right now, all Board and Commission members are limited to two consecutive three-year terms, where it is a three-year term. That's the longest term we have these days. We felt that for historical perspective, for the boards that have some quasi-judicial authority, as well as for the Conservation Commission, which does the reviews from a land and open space criteria for the Planning Board, that it was worthwhile to have citizens be able to serve for nine consecutive years on those boards. That is based, I think that's item number 60, getting into item 67. But item number 66 would make the appropriate changes in ordinance section 4-2-2 and section 19-4-6 about eliminating the associate member position. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Is anybody from the public would like to make a comment one way or the other as far as the changes? Hearing none, therefore, I'll close the public hearing and move on to item 66, to consider proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance and to the boards and commissions ordinance that would expand the planning board and the zoning board to seven members and eliminating the associate members and take any necessary action. Do I hear a motion?
I would move the recommendation.
Second.
Any comments from the council? One way or the other. Counsel McGlaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to thank the planning board, the chairman, Tom Emery, in the audience this evening for their response and their very timely processing of this request. That was quite short notice to the board members, and you have before you this evening their recommendation to move ahead with what is before you this evening. Thank you.
Anyone else? It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor? All those opposed? It's six to one unopposed, Counsel McGlaughlin, I mean, Cogshaw. Item 67, to consider a proposed amendments to the statement of policy, appointments to the standing boards and commissions that would permit members of the planning board, zoning board, and conservation commission to serve a three consecutive terms and take any necessary action. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any comment? Anybody on the board care to comment one way or the other, the changes? Hearing none, we'll move on to the vote. All those in favor, signify by raising your right hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, seven to nothing. Item 68, consider a report from the planning board recommending the adoption of the town center zone related to amendments to the zoning ordinance and take any necessary action. I believe the manager has a comment.
Yes, I'd just like to comment, the planning board's been working on this for quite some time, following an earlier report of the town center committee, and Tom Emery, the chairman of the planning committee, is here, planning board, excuse me, is here to present an overview of the proposal.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, councilors. Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, has asked that I come this evening and make a brief presentation to some of the critical attributes to the town center zone. The planning board has deliberated, as Mike noted, for over a year. I'll use the old joke, I had hair when we started. And that was after several months of diligent work by the town center plan committee, chaired by Bruce Cogshaw. At our last meeting, we had a public hearing, received quite a bit of public input, some very basic questions about why should we worry about people walking in the town center, to some very detailed questions regarding some of the design issues and issues related to bike traffic and on-street parking, but I'll get to that in a little more detail. So needless to say, we've had quite a thorough discussion on this. There was one, as members of the public may know, there was an article in the paper regarding the town center zone, and there was a graphic illustrating a town green in the middle of the, in front of the shopping center. And I think it's important for the record, for the public, to understand that that is just simply a concept plan. This is a zoning ordinance, it's not a plan or an implementation of a particular engineered drawing. The basic elements of the plan include, first of all, I'd like to acknowledge, as I said, Bruce Cogshaw, the committee chair, Maureen O'Meara's diligent work in helping to revise the ordinance that was drafted by the committee. My fellow planners, John Mitchell, who worked diligently on the graphics, and we believe this being a first opportunity to include graphics within the ordinance while giving an idea of what we're looking for in terms of design allows us to use more narrative language rather than specific guidelines when one's dealing with somewhat subjective requirements. And also the public comment, both during the committee process as well as the review of the ordinance. The ordinance does several things. First, it establishes the geographic limits for the town center zone. And there were some questions raised at the public hearing, and we refined that to be very specific about where those zone lines fall. And the zone is, again, not arbitrary at all. It's based on several of the following items. The town center plan, which was prepared by a town committee with town volunteers, and which had held several public hearings during the process. And the committee, I believe, recommended Scheme A, which was the simplest, most direct approach. The town center plan had recommendations and a draft ordinance, which served as the basis for our work. And then we followed with many workshops and public hearings. The ordinance includes a definition of critical issues related to the town center. We also prepared a purpose statement. If nothing else within an ordinance, if one can always fall back on the purpose statement to understand what the zone is for, what it's about, it's extremely helpful. It also carries with it the historic information with respect to why the ordinance was drafted initially. One thing that's an advantage in working in small communities is there's always someone on a planning board or a town council that's been there for a couple of hundred years, and when one is interpreting an ordinance, that person will usually speak up and say, wait a minute, I remember when that was drafted, and this was the real intent or the real purpose. So we feel this is a very important part of the ordinance. The main issues related to that is the establishment of identifiable town center, a sense of community center, a sense of place for Cape Elizabeth. We wanted that to be sure that that had a village scale feeling appropriate to the town as it currently exists, that it encouraged mixed uses, including residential, retail, and commercial uses, that it created a pedestrian-friendly environment. I was thinking about this today. This was one of the questions that came up during the public hearing. How many people are really going to walk from Shore Road through the town center to get to the shopping center or some other place? As you drive around many small main communities and cities, you'll notice sidewalks, street trees, and not necessarily a lot of people walking, but there's a certain sense of scale and quietness and commercial activity that I think is appropriate to the town center and that is certainly appropriate to the inconsistent with the town center report. We're also looking for visual cohesiveness. What does that mean? Does that mean all the buildings are the same? No, it doesn't. But it means that you don't build a Walmart next to a small residential scale building. And we're also looking for the opportunities for linkages to open spaces. That is, the town center has a lot of open space amenity with the school facilities. And although it's easy to forget in a bedroom community, we have many adjacent neighborhoods, including one in which I live, so it's easy to walk to the town center and take advantage of those open space opportunities. The town center location was chosen because of its the prevalence of existing public buildings, a very important part of creating activity within the town center, the existing commercial uses, and the historic compact development patterns. And lastly, the statement purpose alludes to the fact that the ordinance is tailored to the unique characteristics of the town center and tries to build on those rather than picking arbitrary models around the state. We've included, flip the chart here. There's a list of permitted uses. Most important items here is the fact that the school facilities and the municipal facilities are now included as permitted uses rather than special exceptions or conditional uses. And there's a list of permitted uses here. I won't go through them all, but it looks to build on the existing use patterns in the town center. That's probably waking up somebody. The other thing that we've done is listed prohibited uses, which is important with an ordinance that things aren't hidden, that it says directly up front what's not permitted. And one of those is adult entertainment, if I remember correctly. As we were deliberating the ordinance, it just happened that was an issue with many communities, and we felt this was the time to deal with it. We have also within the town center dimensional requirements. And the existing ordinance speaks of dimensional requirements as if all the building uses were the same. The draft ordinance considers three different building types. One are schools, which have, as we went through the review of the new school addition, The school department requested that we look at their setbacks in context with the unique buildings and parking needs. The municipal buildings also have their set of standards, and then we have all other setback standards. One of the main points to look at in terms of standards is what we refer to as the front yard setback. And in many towns, people try to get the buildings as far back as possible to encourage a sense of activity, to slow down traffic speed and so forth. This ordinance requires buildings to be closer to the street. We have a maximum setback distance included in the ordinance. The main elements of the zoning include design requirements. This is really a difficult area to deal with because once one gets into design requirements, one gets into some subjective areas and areas that can be easily argued, as two attorneys can argue either side of a case, two architects could easily argue either side of an aesthetic issue, and urban designers, I suppose, could do the same. But the design requirements apply to any development that requires site plan review, new construction, or exterior alteration to what is deemed in the ordinance as a historically significant structure, the emphasis there being on exterior alteration. Certainly, the design requirements are not intended that all buildings look the same, but simply to encourage unity and a sense of sanity within the town center. I also think that it's interesting in looking at the standards, that these standards are very much narrative standards, not A, B, C, this big, this wide, this tall, this far back, only this material, and so forth. Just briefly, the elements that we looked at in terms of design standards. Include building footprint, that is, how big is a building. And looking at some of the existing uses in town, it was determined that a building of a certain square footage was probably as big as one would want to get without creating some change in the facade or setback or other configuration change. We looked at scale, that's the overall height to the mass of the building, and to be sure that new buildings are in scale with the existing buildings in the town center, and that buildings are large enough to create a presence in the town center, that buildings are not too small. An element, we looked at height and roof pitch and came up with a minimum roof pitch and encouraged the use of sloped roofs, which are consistent with the existing roof forms in the town center. We looked at buildings and parking orientation. In many towns, one can easily see sort of the deterioration of buildings and the loss of buildings along the street to the creation of parking lots. What we're encouraging is the location of parking lots, or requiring is the location of parking lots to the side of the buildings, no closer to the street than the front of the building, or placed behind. During some of the public hearings, there was a concern raised regarding the difficulty of managing a small business when one has a parking lot in the front, a parking lot in the back and the main entrance in the front. Normally that requires two employees as a minimum. We looked at alleviating that by having parking on the side and having entrances to the side that would have direct access to the street front as well. We looked at openings, that is, the size of windows that should stay consistent with the existing buildings. Again, if you see the graphics in the ordinance, we show, we felt was a very easy way for even lay people to understand, as we show good examples or compatible examples and not compatible examples. And every rule there's an exception, and we'll deal with those exceptions as they come before us, but I think the general intent is stated in those graphic presentations. Number six, one that is someone who's in the design profession, exterior materials, knowing what this building is wrapped in is always a difficult area to deal with because you really start getting into personal choices. But we're simply stating that wood, if you're using metal or metal roof, the copper would be encouraged. Natural brick, natural materials are encouraged. Vinyl, concrete block, aluminum siding, vinyl siding are not prohibited, but they're discouraged, particularly where existing buildings are being renovated. Then we set up what we refer to as landscaping and front yard setback, and grouped within that three areas. One was a streetscape, and identified within that front yard setback what appropriate street furnishing, so to speak, should be there, where the lighting would be appropriately placed, where on-street parking should be located, if benches should be placed in front of stores and signs and so forth. We created guidelines for the location of parking as well as access to the building from the parking into the street. And lastly, a buffer requirement for non-compatible and adjacent uses. One thing that this ordinance does do is it encourages people who have adjacent properties to take advantage of that adjacency and to connect their parking areas, therefore minimizing as much as possible curb cuts into Route 77. And lastly, we have an item referred to as a building permit where we're asking that anyone who's seeking a demolition permit for removal of a historic a building, again, that's been identified as historically significant, make notice 30 days prior to scheduled demolition to the town manager so that, as with Portland, significant buildings are historic in two ways. They have historic characteristics, their design characteristics, but they're also unique to the growth patterns of the community. I guess, although this is an example in the town center, the Grange Hall on Route 207 in Scarborough is a good example where the state, that building is threatened to be torn down because of the realignment of Route 207 in Scarborough. And the state finds no historic significance in that building, and yet, from an urban design standpoint, the building's quite significant because of its cultural importance to the community in the recent past. That generally is an overview of the draft ordinance before you, and if you have any questions, I'd be pleased to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you. Has anybody got any questions from Ms. Tamory? No questions. Thank you. Very good. So moving right along, has anybody got any comments on item 68? I shall read the item. To consider a report from the Planning Board recommending the adoption of the Town Center Zone related to amendments to the zoning ordinance and take any necessary action. What is your wishes? Any comments? Sorry.
Since somebody has to say something here, I will move that the report be referred to the Ordinance Committee to appropriately include it in its ordinances and make recommendations to the Council.
Second.
Thank you. Been moved and seconded. Does anybody get a comment?
By the way, I would also urge on something like that, people who are involved or have concerns, when the Ordinance Committee workshop takes place, to show up at that workshop. It's a lot easier than maybe coming later on to a council meeting.
I have a couple of comments. Maybe I don't understand the way they're worded and what have you. And it was number 7 as far as gas stations and repair garages, except that gas stations shall be limited to one island and have no more than 4 fueling points with no more than 2 gas dispensers. And it seems so, pumps that I see have 3 fueling points on each side of them for the different types of fuel. So I think that should be looked at hard, and also radio towers and exposed satellite dishes shall not be allowed except for exclusive municipal uses. The base of the municipal satellite dishes and radio towers shall be screened from the public view. So one, if it's mounted on top of a roof, is gonna be screened, is that correct? By the way, that's what I just hope they'll
great
look
idea
into them, and I'd like to be notified when they work on this ordinance, because I'd like to be present.
Our meetings are always public and published ahead of time. I would recommend that invite, if possible, the planner would be there, but if Mr. Emery would care to attend. We will not probably be having a meeting until January, so.
Okay, moving on. Anybody else got any questions?
We need a vote.
Comments? I'm gonna vote. So we'll move for a vote. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a vote, 7-0. Item 69, to consider a proposed renewal of a full-time malt, spirituous, and vinous liquor license for Susan T. Legg, is that the way it pronounced? Events Incorporated at the Inn by the Sea and taking necessary action. I believe our town clerk, Debbie, will take care of that one.
Thank you. In your council packet, you do have an application that has been filled out by Susan T. Legg Events, Inc. at Inn by the Sea. According to a new council policy, it was approved back in January of '94. Since this item, and actually the next item as well, are renewal applications, a formal public hearing is not required. But your policy does state that you would provide public comment if anyone would like to comment before the council does vote. And so this item is ready for the council to sign. The code enforcement officer, health officer, fire chief, and police chief have also been notified, and they do not have any problems with this.
Thank you. Does anybody from the public care to comment one way or the other as far as the license? Everybody out there is non-drinkers, so I guess they don't care. So do I hear a motion?
I move acceptance of the approval of the license.
Second.
Any other comment? Been moved and seconded. All in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. Item 70. To consider a proposed renewal of a full-time malt, spirituals, and finest liquor license for the Papoota Club and take any necessary action. That is yours, I believe.
Yes. Again, this is a renewal of this application and the same policy as we stated before. There has been no objections from any of the town staff that were notified on this. This also does include a special amusement permit for the Papoota Club, and Mr. DiOrio, who is the manager, is present to answer any questions if you have any.
Mr. Chairman, the president of the Papoota Club as well is in attendance.
Is in attendance?
He's
yes.
Here.
Mr. Chairman, due to a perceived conflict of interest, I cannot vote on this issue.
Thank you. Everybody agree?
Due to a perceived conflict of interest, I also have to withdraw in voting on this issue.
Anybody else? Thank you. You're allowed to. Anyone there from the Papoota Club to make a comment one way or the other? Please come down to the podium and state your name.
Yeah, good evening to the council. My name is Dave Sherman, and I'm here on behalf of Papoota Club as its president. And I'd be happy to answer any questions that the council may have regarding the renewal of the liquor license.
Any of the council remaining allowed to vote on this issue? Got to make a comment. I guess you're home free.
Okay.
I have no comment, and I guess no one else does. Yes, excuse me. Councilor McLaughlin.
We do have also the special amusement permit. I've figured out the handwriting. How often is the live entertainment provided?
How often is live entertainment provided? Mm-hmm. Oh, typically during our winter calendar, we have a monthly activity. Mm-hmm. And generally during those monthly activities, we have live entertainment at the club, depending specifically on the calendar.
Great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Anybody else? Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I move approval of these two licenses.
Second it.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment? All those in favor? Those opposed? So vote. 5-0-2. Item 71, to consider a report from Hunter Norris Associates on the operation of the town sewage system and take any necessary action. Mr. Pettit, I believe you had a few opening comments.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Jordan. About a year ago, the Sewer Study Committee, or the Sewer Advisory Committee, Board of Sewer Appeals, as it was called at that point in time, recommended a number of actions regarding the operation of the town sewerage system. One of the recommendations was that we look into whether or not it is best to stay with the Portland Water District in continuing to operate our Southern Cape sewer system treatment plant and interceptors and pump stations, as well as the management for us of this, our relationship with South Portland for the Northern Cape sewerage and the pump stations and interceptors on that end of town. As a result of that study, or that request from the sewer committee, the town council a while ago authorized me to sign an agreement with Hunter Norris to do a study of the system, to look at the different expenses, to look at different options. Bob Hunter is here this evening to give about a 10-minute overview of the report. Dan Jellis, who's the general manager of the Portland Water District, and David Golombewski of the Water District are also here. They have worked very closely with us as we've prepared the report to make sure that we're using correct data. Particularly their finance area has been extremely helpful, and they're here to answer any questions you may have, and I understand Mr. Jellis would like to make a few comments following Mr. Hunter's presentation.
Thank you. Mr. Hunter.
We haven't had flip charts in a while.
Well, you can't get these architects and engineers to talk without a flip chart. I certainly appreciated the
Bob, just might slant that slightly because I'm sure a lot of the viewers at home would like to see that. They're coming off of a camera at the right.
A lot smaller these days.
Most of us can see around corners.
Okay.
Could you state your name, please?
I'm Bob Hunter, the president of Hunter Norris, the people who prepared the report. I would like to say that I very much appreciate having the opportunity to serve the town and doing this very interesting study. Those of you who have seen the report recognize there's a very large amount of data and analysis that's in there, and we can't possibly go over it all this evening. But I thought it would be helpful, perhaps, for me to kind of give you an overview of the planning process that we went through and some of the key findings that we arrived at. The evaluation process was basically made up of six components of work. The first was reviewing the current technical operations of the facilities, i.e. what is its capacities, are they complying with the license and permit conditions that they have, and what are the potential upcoming problems that the town may have to face. The second was a review of the current operation, maintenance, and administration costs of the system. And that would be in two parts. One, the town cost, and second, the costs that are incurred by the Portland Water District. The third element would be then to compare these operation and maintenance costs for the Cape Elizabeth system with other typical communities in the greater Portland area. And to try to get them on an equivalent basis, it would be done on a cost per gallon per day treated or a cost per pound of BOD that goes through the plant. Fourth would be to evaluate alternative institutional systems or alternative ways of how the system could be operated. We then established tentative operating costs for the alternate systems, and finally a review of non-financial issues that have to be considered when you read the report. Reviewing the technical operations, as I'm sure you all know, the Cape Elizabeth system is made up of two distinct components. One is the northern system, which services the area basically from the intersection of Spearwink Road and Route 77 northerly to the South Portland town line. And the wastewater from there goes to the South Portland treatment plant. The southern system services the Pond Cove area here and southerly along the shore. That is carried to the treatment plant that is located on Spurwink Road. The operating responsibilities of the system are currently split between the town and the Portland Water District. This split occurred back in 1972 when the Portland Water District developed the regional plans for sewering the greater Portland area. And at that time, each community was given the option of joining the district's regional system or proceeding on its own. Cape Elizabeth agreed to join the water district in a regional system. Through that, the Portland Water District was responsible for building, maintaining, and operating the treatment plant, interceptor sewers, and the pump stations, whereas the town would maintain the, would construct and maintain the collector sewers that serve the various neighborhoods. That operating responsibility split has been in place for about 22 years now. The permitted capacity of the systems at the northern system is about 0.716 million gallons per day. The southern system is 0.52 MGD. We looked at the operation of the facilities and tried to determine what are the approximate available capacities that are currently in the systems. And the northern system would have about 150,000 gallons per day. That is higher than it previously was because when South Portland expanded their treatment plant, the district on behalf of the town increased the capacity by about 216,000 gallons per day. We reviewed the operational performance, and I can say that the operation of both the northern and southern system have been very good. They've consistently met all of the license requirements, and I believe that the DEP is quite satisfied with the operations that are taking place. We also, in conjunction with the district's operating staff, tried to identify some upcoming problems that are going to have to be addressed in the next perhaps 5 to 10 years. The infiltration inflow into both the northern system and the southern system is excessive and is costing money to pass that flow through the system. This is not a new problem. I'm sure you've heard of this over the past several years. But I think as South Portland tightens their system up, and unless you tighten yours up also, you're going to be paying a greater percentage of the costs of operating the South Portland treatment plant. The second problem is in the northern system, particularly at the pump stations. Those facilities are now 20 years old, and much of the equipment in the stations are reaching the end of their useful life, and over the next several years will have to be upgraded or replaced. But essentially, the system has operated very well. It's meeting all of its requirements. And I think it shows that both the town and the Portland Water District have done a good job of maintaining their systems. Looking at the financial end of it, we looked at the current budgets that are in place. And we had, when we did this study, we had the 1994 operating budget that had been prepared by the Portland Water District. They also made available to us detailed breakdowns of the actual 1993 operating costs. In 1994, the budget for operation and maintenance, this is the northern and southern system combined, was about $850,000. Debt service for retiring the bonds that are currently outstanding, about $550,000, for a total annual cost of $1.4 million. The actual 1993 operating costs were $813,000 for O&M, $560,000 for debt service, for a total of $1,373,000. Now, of those costs, the town pays about 5% of the operation and maintenance, and the district has responsibility for about 95% of the operation and maintenance. On the debt service, the town has 67% of the debt service, the district about 33%. All of these annual costs are passed through to the users of the system in the form of user charges that are paid relative to the amount of water that is used in each home. The next step in the system was to try to look at the Cape Elizabeth's operating maintenance and administrative costs in comparison with other typical communities that are in the area. And I would say that the other communities that we talked with were very helpful in providing us data and assisting us in understanding how they operate their systems. To try to look at it on an equivalent basis, we set these costs up in so many dollars per gallon per day that is passed through and treated by the system. The Cape Elizabeth system, based on 1993 data, combining the northern and southern system, was about 99 cents per gallon per day. Interestingly, you can see South Portland is significantly the lowest at about 39 cents per gallon per day. And that would be expected, and it's a much larger system, and there are economies of scale when you are treating the flows at a larger system. The towns that are perhaps more comparable with Cape Elizabeth would be the Scarborough Sanitary District at 81 cents, Town of Falmouth at 67 cents, Town of Yarmouth is 46 cents, and the Freeport Sewer District was 92 cents per gallon per day. Those four average out at about 74 cents per gallon per day. Now, I would note that that Scarborough and Freeport are sanitary authorities or districts that have been set up to run the sewer system. The other communities are run by the municipality. You'll see that the sewer district operations appear to be a little higher. I think there's perhaps two reasons for that. One, that they have to maintain an independent clerical and support staff rather than sharing personnel with other town functions. And also, as a separate operating district, they indeed have to account fairly rigidly for all costs that are with the sewer system, wherein municipal budgets, some effort that goes to the sewer sometimes gets slid into other types of budgets. So that is not an unusual circumstance.
I don't think it's exactly 99 cents per gallon per day. It's a little high, but I think it shows the relative relationships.
You arguing with my numbers, Mr. McGovern?
We'll talk about it later. Just adds up to an awful lot of money, Bob.
It does.
Mike, can I just ask a question here? What I thought in the report it was $1.09.
This is strictly operation and maintenance. The renewal and replacement, certain engineering costs and other rather that aren't directly related to operation and maintenance were taken out for a comparative basis. So those numbers may not be exactly as you saw in the report. Okay. I tried to do it in order to get an equivalent number for each town, and their accounting systems aren't exactly the same, so you have to kind of use a little discretion in how you compare the numbers.
Thank you.
We then looked and tried to determine what were the alternative institutional systems that could be considered for operating the system. And I've listed four of them here. One is to continue the joint town public Portland Water District operation as it currently exists, and an estimated annual budget for operation and maintenance only, again excluding the debt service, which will be about the same regardless of who is managing the system, of $770,000 per year. The second option would be for the town to take over the operation of the system and to operate it as a section of the municipal government. That was estimated about 671,000 gallons per day. A third option could be to contract with the city of South Portland, who now treats the northern system waste, to operate and maintain the system. That was estimated roughly 675,000 gallons per day. Or you could contract with an independent private operator. And again, I would estimate that cost to be essentially the same as if it were a town operation. There was a fifth alternative that was looked at initially, and that was contracting with the Scarborough Sanitary District to try to operate this system. After initial discussions with them, they determined that they did not think it was in their best interest to try to take that on at this time. Now, I would say that when you're comparing these sorts of operations, you have to be very careful in looking at, are you providing an equivalent level of service? And that's a very subjective thing that's very difficult to get a firm handle on. We have tried in working with the district and with the town manager to try to set these so we feel we are getting a generally equivalent level of service. But that is an area that can be controversial. As you can see, the approximate cost differential between the current town and water district operating procedures is about $100,000 per year. Now, on a unit cost basis, that would be about 70 cents per gallon per day. And as I indicated, the average of Scarborough, Freeport, Yarmouth, and Falmouth was about 74 cents. So it fits generally in that range. So that summarizes basically the cost factors. I think you do have to recognize, however, that there are some non-financial issues that will have to be addressed as this is being considered. As we indicated, the Portland Water District has incurred substantial debt and bonds on behalf of the town, and how that would, if the town chose to either go with a private operation or set up a municipal department, the disposition of the existing bonds that are in the water district's name would have to be resolved. There also, obviously, are a number of legal issues that would have to be resolved. Also, the regional sewage system was established, and certain aspects of it were defined by legislative action, and it may or may not require legislative action if the town should want to significantly change the relationships they currently have with the district. On the basis of the study, our recommendation would be that the town should consider controlling the annual operation, maintenance, and administrative costs by adopting an alternative institutional system or by modifying or working with the Portland Water District to modify the contract and the operating procedures that they now have to see whether all or some portion of the estimated $100,000 cost differential could be secured. I know it's a very complicated and long report, and we'll probably have other discussions, but if there's anything that I can answer at this time, I'd be glad to try to do so.
Thank you. Very good. Anybody got a question for Mr. Hunter? Hearing none? Oh, you've already...
Quick question. Are you aware of any precedents of other communities doing this kind of thing?
Doing...
Well, sort of breaking... this kind of thing. One of the options, breaking away from Portland Water District... that kind of arrangement
No, I don't think so. The Portland Water District, there were several communities that did join the system. I think that Portland, Westbrook, Gorham, and Cumberland, Pye, and Cape Elizabeth are in the district regional system. South Portland, Scarborough, Yarmouth, and Freeport operate independently. All of those that joined the regional system back in 1972 are still members of the system. So this is the first time that this has been reviewed in this manner.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Thank you, Bob. Now, I believe it's Mr. Jealous from the water company has some rebuttal. That's the way I should put it. Thank you. Introduce yourself.
I'm Dan Jealous, General Manager of the Portland Water District, and no, I don't have any rebuttal, but I would just like to make a few remarks based on our review of the report. And Starting off by, you know, thanking Mike and Bob Hunter and of Hunter Norris and the amount of time that they were willing to spend with us as they were developing the report to make sure that the information that they had from us was as accurate as possible. Because as Bob did relate, it's very difficult under this situation to come up with an apples-to-apples comparison when you're comparing an existing system with some proposed systems. But I would suggest that Bob has done a very good job of doing that as he's put these comparisons together. The comparison showed that the town department option estimate was about $100,000. Less than the our actual cost in 1993, or the cost of the existing system, the joint district-town system, which is about 7.2% less than the current system. In my view, I believe that the comparison shows that the existing system is competitive when you take into account a couple of factors. One of them being the framework of the regional system. Is such that, as Bob indicated, we have to fully allocate our costs our costs have to be allocated to the users that are using the system, which is basically the municipalities that we serve. And the second level, second reason that I suggest that the comparison is competitive is that our high level of service that the district provides. We do take great pride in our very strong preventative maintenance program and have built it into a basically preventative maintenance work ethic try very hard not to get into a breakdown maintenance mode, because once you do that, it's very, very difficult to back out of it. So it's very important to try to put that level of effort in up front on an ongoing basis so that you don't have to make attempts to catch up at the end. One of the things that the report did suggest that is in the council's review, as you're reviewing the results of the report, is a part of the town's evaluation is to evaluate the district's success at containing costs, or more importantly, its ability to contain costs in the future and keep them in line and being responsive to the town's needs. And I guess I would like to suggest that we've been very successful at that in the past, and make the commitment to you that we will continue to do that in the future. We recognize that there's always room for improvement, and it's our goal to try to do that. One measure of our success to date is that our assessments have increased very moderately since 1991, and we've just met with Mike this afternoon go over or review the 1995 assessment, and that's basically flat from 1994. We are trying to contain our costs, and in return still trying to keep a high level of treatment permit compliance and pump station and interceptor reliability. The other key factor that I think Bob has hit on in his report, and an item that we would strongly concur with, is that's the reported need to set aside some funds to reduce the infiltration inflow in your collector system and rehabilitate some of your older collection system sewers. Basically, that extraneous water that's getting into the sewer system can be translated directly into long-range treatment costs. And by removing that infiltration inflow, you can reduce the risk of sewage backups as well. So there's definitely the need to do some more work there. And in summary, I would hope that as you evaluate the report, you hear that we say that hopefully our efforts at holding our line on costs and still providing good service will give you the leeway that you need to be able to come up with the funds to be able to do that work on the collection system. And with that in mind, we're willing to work with you as you move ahead in evaluating the study and your sewer system needs. And I'd be happy to answer any questions, or David now or later if you wish.
Okay. Thank you. Has anybody got any questions? Mr. Jell? Yes? No? Okay, I guess they're all set. Thank you. Does any member of the council have any questions one way or the other? Or care to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman? I propose a motion that we forward the Hunter Norris Sewer Report to the Sewer Ordinance Advisory Committee for their review and recommendations.
Movements, I hear a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Has anybody got any comment, one way or the other? Councilor Dahlbeck?
I guess I have a question, and I'd look to the town manager on this. I think my own feeling would be that if I were going to have something done with the report, at this stage, be asking the town manager, assisted by the Public Works Director, to make specific recommendations. I'm not too sure whether the Sewer Ordinance Committee is appropriate at this stage.
Yeah. The reason it was suggested that it go back to the committee is because they were the committee that initiated the study and requested the council to do it. It was felt that they ought to have a chance to really have a look at it and to comment upon it prior to actual, you know, final recommendations coming forward, just in as a way of keeping this a participatory process.
I guess that's all right. It sounds like we're 6 months away from a decision.
That is true. When you do refer it to the committee, it does take longer to make a decision.
Okay.
I would like to make one other comment before you vote on this, and that is to thank Bob Hunter for all of his efforts on this study. It wasn't the easiest study to do, because I think, as one of the questions indicated, it's an unusual thing to look at. And Bob really kept to it over a period of time, and along with the help of the district and the cooperation of the city, particularly the city of South Portland, it has been an effort that I think not only is useful for the initial purpose it intended, but also there's many other gems of information here that are also useful as we look at other sewer issues.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Following up on Councilor Dahlbeck's comment, and I perceive concern of the time frame, question to Mr. McGovern, do you feel it's reasonable for us to put a 6 months or shorter, different time frame on this request to the Sewer Ordinance Advisory Committee?
I haven't surveyed the committee members to see what their winter schedules are. You know, obviously, if, you know, I think the town has made a significant investment in the report. It does have some cost implications. I would think the sooner you could get back a recommendation, the better.
6 months would be May.
Okay.
Thank you.
Councilor Cogdill.
I would like us to address these non-financial issues before we spend too much time and money continuing this approach, to answer those three questions primarily. I think we need to have some idea of the answers to those questions before we continue.
The issue is number two, general legal issues, is an area that is two pieces to it. One, it would be very expensive to do all of the legal research necessary to figure out how, if you will pardon the expression, a divorce might take place. It'd be like any other divorce. Sometimes you get into more complicated issues than you'd like, and we've tended to avoid the legal issues up to this point, hoping, and I think this is the second piece of it, hoping that, you know, it would, if it comes to that point, that it would be a very cooperative separation, and one that we could work together to resolve the legal issues instead of going down two separate paths. We can do some preliminary work, although, you know, I've just held off doing them to this point, not knowing whether or not this is going to go forward. But, you know, we could easily spend $5,000 on legal issues and legal research without getting into this too deeply.
Yes, Councilor Cogdill.
Is there a recommendation or a general feeling you have as a result of this report as to what kind of a formula you may develop for the Sewer Advisory Committee?
I have my own, having read the report and having discussed it with the district, with Mr. Hunter and others, I do have my own personal feelings about it. I haven't shared those with anyone up to this point as to, you know, what my recommendation would be.
Sounds like it's a timely time.
Now?
I would prefer to review it first with the committee and not get, you know, they might have additional knowledge that might persuade me to move in a different direction than the one I would currently go. While I feel comfortable with the direction I'm going in, my sense, it's not something that I want to close the door or get the sense that the committee is fighting against me on my position, whatever they might do. I'd be happy to tell you, but I am just trying to keep as open a mind on this as possible.
Councilor Nell.
Yes, I was going to suggest that some of the non-financial issues be looked into concurrently as the sewer ordinance advisory committee looks into it, but having heard the manager's remarks that there's some expense involved, I think it would be prudent to let the sewer ordinance advisory committee take a look at it and have their response. That makes sense to me.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor Dahlbeck.
I guess in the interest of time, you know, I can see something bouncing back and forth and what have you. I'd like to think that the next time this comes to the council, it not only has been through them, but it has been through the town manager and the director of public works and comes with a specific recommendation which covers the non-financial issues as well, so that there's something to vote on and not just to refer to somebody else again.
Was there a deadline in the motion?
No.
I would, I will say publicly that it'd be my intention to work with the committee to provide a response to that request, something to vote upon that would first come on the April Town Council agenda. In other words, the committee, sewer committee, would work on it primarily in January, February, and March.
Could we amend the motion to include that April date?
Sure.
Make the motion. Jen?
Councilor Nell made the motion.
Sure.
It's agreeable. So by the end of March, they'd have their work done.
It would,
for the April council meeting?
April council. Might be done by April 1.
Friendly amendment.
Let's say the end of March, I think.
Thank you.
I think that's what.
We're just hammering out language.
That'd be a good time?
That's fine.
Okay. I think that's, in my opinion, is the right way to go. I thought the council might want to give the sewer planning committee some direction as far as the thinking, if there is any thinking right now. And the cost factor, to me, is going to be the answer to the report of which way we go. So we'll let them do the legwork and put for an answer in April. Anybody else got any comment? Are you ready for the vote? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a vote, 7-0. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Item 72, to consider a proposed amendment to the town ways and ordinances and take any necessary action. I believe you or the public works director is going to.
Yes, I'll make a very brief comment. From time to time, we look at different ordinances as state mandates come forward and as other issues come forward. One of the areas that Bob Malley, our director of public works, has been looking at recently is our town ways ordinance and how it complies with the dig safe law that's now in effect. And Bob has proposed a number of recommendations, which I think are well thought out, and he's here this evening to present an overview of those.
Thank you. The town ways ordinance, which primarily governs driveway entrances and street opening excavation standards, was last amended in 1988. At that time, we did some major revisions on the technical standards, on restoration in streets, and the like. Since that time, it's worked very well, but we now need to make some minor amendments to incorporate our DigSafe language into the system. I don't know if you're all familiar with DigSafe, but it's a word that's used quite heavily now. And DigSafe, the DigSafe Corporation is a clearinghouse for communications to let utilities and members such as municipalities know of proposed excavations in streets and private ways. And in the past, if you needed to make an underground excavation, you would come, get a form from us, you would have to contact each individual utility by phone. Now you can use one phone number, it's an 800 number out of Massachusetts, that you call, and these people notify all the utilities. So it's a lot easier system for the contractor, it's an easier system for us, especially now that we're members. We get notified of proposed excavations for a nominal fee. So it's really put us in the loop of communication for excavation, so it's made a big, big difference. So we need to really incorporate that language into our standards. The ordinance is made up of five different articles. Article 1, there are no changes. Article 2, there's simply a sentence that's been added at the end, which says a permit fee established by the town council shall be paid for each permit, and the schedule of fees is on the back page. Article 3 is where most of the amendment is made, which calls for language related to our DigSafe membership. Paragraph A specifies how sites shall be identified and marked. Paragraph B details information that's now required on our application. When you go to take out a street opening permit, you first have to fill out an application. You have to supply us with a certificate of insurance. So we need to incorporate that DigSafe language on that application. And what that basically involves is putting a DigSafe confirmation number on the application. Besides that, when you get to section 17.3.5, 17.3.6, are really this miscellaneous technical language that I probably won't bore you with, but there's a lot of numbers in there and technical things that you can read through. 17.3.8 is a deletion of a sentence. At one time, the theory was that you would require a concrete cap in a street excavation that would prevent the settling of hot top. Technology and experience has now proved that to be unwise, so that's being deleted. 17.3.11, we have increased the penalties nominally. And on the back page are the proposed fee schedule. I'm proposing to increase three different items, two of which are concrete sidewalks and concrete driveways. The current fee right now is $30 per square yard. I'm proposing to increase that to $40 a square yard, which is more reflective of the current costs to replace those items. And our street opening fee is currently $5, and I'm proposing that that be increased to $30. It sounds like a major jump, but when we get a call from DigSafe and we have to go out and make locations in the street, it really covers our administrative time and our time to go out into the field to make these locations, to research plans if that needs to be done. So it really it takes a little bit more time than it used to, and I think this this amount here reflects that a little bit better. That's really it in a nutshell. Unless you have questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
Anybody got a question, comment? Mr. Malley?
Just, it is being recommended that this be referred to the Ordinance Committee as it is an amendment to an ordinance.
Go ahead. You?
We're just wondering if it really does need to.
Go to the Ordinance Committee?
Thank you, fellas.
It's just so straightforward.
It's so straightforward. Why waste them a couple months?
This should be voted on tonight.
I would like to move the suggestions made by the Public Works Director.
I'll second that.
And moved and seconded.
Just as a matter of practice, the town charter requires before the adoption of any ordinance amendment that you hold a public hearing.
Yeah.
I would move that it goes to public hearing
next month.
At our next regular meeting.
At 7:30 p.m.
At 7:30 p.m., whatever date.
December 12th.
That's a good date.
Is the gentleman with the second agreeable to that?
Phyllis keeps
amended motion?
Why not again?
At the town hall.
At the town hall. Oh, good.
Yeah, please do it properly.
Do I hear the second over there?
You do.
Oh, sorry, I didn't hear it first. Got one comment before we vote?
Yes.
I know why this dig safe deal is here, because of writing within the street, and I think it's a damn shame that it has to go on, that it couldn't be accomplished some other way. And I want to ask one question. If they got to make the letters as large as they are, and why can't they go the other way in the street, so you'd have to look this way if you walked up to see where they were digging, you'd read the name instead of having it the way it is. I know why it's where it is, but it's good advertising.
I would agree with you and not comment any further.
But can it be written the other way?
Sure can, and what you really should do is we try to encourage the contractors to paint the name where they're going to be digging, so once the excavation takes place, everything's gone. So that's an even better system, but...
Have we got to write that in here?
I hope not.
I might add, Mr. Chairman, all of the contractors who currently work in Cape Elizabeth are fully cooperating with this ordinance at this time, and we appreciate their cooperation. They have, particularly a number of the contractors have seen the draft ordinance and may comment upon it at the public hearing, but they are all cooperating with it at this time. We appreciate their assistance and their cooperation, and it nonetheless, you know, people then ask, well, you know, why do you need to come up with different rules and regulations? And that's primarily because there may be other contractors who come into town at other times in the future who might not be aware of the rules and the suggestions, and this would get it out before them so they'd be aware of the rules.
Councilor Nell.
In reference to the lettering, I know we've talked about this. I think it's reasonable to limit the letters to 12 inches. I mean, I think that makes sense, and I think it's reasonable to, you know, whether the letters are written across the road or, you know, with the direction of travel, that's, I think that's fine. I would just suggest that instead of company initials, it seems to me that the company name could be there within those, within that parameter. I think that it would remove any ambiguity, possible ambiguity with initials being the same. And I think we'd have nothing to lose by that, and everything to gain. So I'm just suggesting when they look at that, that they consider putting the name again within those parameters of size. Keep it small. That's all. Thank you.
Did you have a comment? A
couple points. Number one, everybody that really needs to know who's doing the excavating is already a member of DigSafe. We're a member of the Water District, so there's really no question as to whose opening that is, because everybody gets called, whether it's public cable, the phone company, or the utilities. We're all members. So there's really no one going there looking for one that is not a member, if that answers your question. But I'm really concerned about, you know, large names in the streets, whether it's 6 inches, 8 inches, or 12 inches, and I think that, you know, the law states that it doesn't have to be identified in the first place, and I think that this is a reasonable compromise for that.
Okay, I know that it doesn't say that. Of course, this is a new program, too, I don't think it. I mean, the reason it's being done is because we had somebody open up something. I mean, we had a problem over it.
Well, yes and no. I mean, in response to Councilor Jordan's question, this would have come before you regardless whether there was, you know, identification in the street or not. We needed to incorporate our membership into DigSafe into this ordinance regardless. So it was coming before you whether we had that problem or not.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Ready for the motion? Everyone understand the motion? I guess so. All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? So vote 7-1. 6-1, excuse me. There's only 7 of us here. How's that?
What's the vote?
Figured that out pretty quick.
Yes. Yes.
Councilor Nell, opposed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 73, to consider setting a public hearing on authorizing the Maine Department of Transportation to commence planning for the bike...
Pedestrian.
Pedestrian shoulders on Shore Road from Fort Williams Park to Route 77 and take any necessary action. I believe Council Nell wants to do that, or you?
Sure. Some months ago, the town manager asked me to talk with the folks at PACS, which is the Portland Area Comprehensive Transportation Committee, and asked me to sort of represent Cape Elizabeth on that committee. It's a forward-looking organization which looks at transportation issues in a regional way to coordinate federal and state regulations and regional needs. And I served on the Alternative Modes Committee, I'm still on that committee. And we looked at a number of projects, and particularly in terms of some of their environmental impacts. And there were dozens of projects proposed for which there is federal money to help pay for these projects. And a couple of them which are proposed, which have not officially been decided, include a bike path, two lights. We looked at a green belt path around the Great Pond. And the issue before us is a bike path on Shore Road. And first of all, I'll say that these proposals were all written up. The work was done by the town manager and his staff before I was on the committee, so the lion's share of the work was done before I was there. But I'd say that there are some issues on the Shore Road. There are proposed bike paths on the sides of Shore Roads, Shore Road that will be looked at. There are certainly some benefits from decreasing the emissions from automobiles. And I know in Maine sometimes that doesn't seem like such a big issue, but more and more we're finding that there's some harmful things come out of automobile exhaust. And automobile travel is predicted to be increased something like 40% in the next 5 or 10 years in Maine. There are some safety issues over on Shore Road. I know before I was on this committee, a couple of citizens mentioned to me that they were concerned about not being able to walk or ride their bikes safely on Shore Road. And in fact, just the other day, a truck driver mentioned to me he was concerned about being on Shore Road because particularly between Delano Park and Lawson Road, if there's somebody on a bicycle in that area, there's really nowhere for them to go. So proposed Shore Road bike path project got some very high marks from the Alternative Modes Committee. And if it's approved, the town would have to come up with 20%, which would be...
$85,000, roughly.
Approximately $85,000. In these tight budget times, that's a lot of money. However, we have to consider that the federal share of that is in the vicinity of $300,000, $320,000 or so. And so those are issues that we need to look at a public hearing, I think, and I think that's what we need to do.
Okay, that's all you have?
Thank you.
Is anybody else want to comment?
Just a brief one. This has been debated for a long time. We had a study done a number of years ago. Every time it's come up, it's been quite controversial. Those folks who favor a bike path, shoulder improvement, and those who are very concerned about the aesthetics and other issues involving properties along there. It was my sense that we ought to, you know, and after some earlier discussion, we ought to see if there might be some resources available. If there are, then the council's really in a position to make a decision, let's go or let's not go. So my hope is that you would have a hearing in January. I skipped over December because of December's December, and put it into, suggest to January so that you would have time to obtain, you know, as much public comment as you wish, and then make a decision either at that meeting or a subsequent meeting on whether or not to move forward. The MDOT has sent out the letters on who's going to be eligible. I expect to receive one tomorrow about this project, and on the December meeting, I'll also be adding an item, putting an item on the agenda, a very similar item that will be for a bikeway on Two Lights Road, based on a letter I expect to receive tomorrow. So that way you'll know everything that's before you, and you can make judgments at that point. I'll also be working with Bob Malley to project out the next 5 years of what we plan to do with roads, because that's the other issue. Where's all the money going to come from if you do decide to do one or both of these?
Anybody care to make a motion? Oh, excuse me, Councilman McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a question for Mr. McGovern. I want to make sure I understand the sequence of events that is possible here. If the council supports pursuing the bike pedestrian shoulders on Shore Road after a public hearing, what happens then? Is it automatic? Is that the last guarantee? Does that guarantee it would be happening, or what?
No. What you would then do, and you know what this item is worded, is to commence planning. It would not be eligible for funding until October of 95. You would then, you know, I would guess, as you did with the traffic light issue, is say that you're not going to give any final authorization until you actually see the plans and approve the plans. At that point, you'd be asked to sign a municipal state agreement that then totally obligates you to the project, to the funds. That would probably be 2 to 3 years away.
Does the approximate $85,000 expenditure on the town side include planning expenses?
It's the project budget, yes.
Even with my concern is that this might get redundant because of the study we've already had done.
What we would do is make available to MDOT the current study, pointing out what was found to be favorable about it and what the negative comments were as well.
Okay. Thank you. I know we have no control over the information that appears in the Cape Courier, but I would hope that some of the previous work for this could be published before that January 9th meeting.
Yeah.
I just think, I know there's been a lot of citizen concern in the past about this, and even though we're not having a public hearing during the busy month of December, people don't always get their minds back in gear too quickly in January either, and I'd like the public to be fully aware of what's going on if we have just one public hearing. Thank you.
Councilor Cogshaw.
I hope in that article that the public does not get the impression that what was proposed before is what we're considering now, because I think we had more negative comments about that particular design, that it was far, far too extensive. And this, I was under the impression, should be more creative and perhaps even meander and not just be a straight shot down the highway.
It has not been designed yet.
No, but those are some of the things that we didn't like about it. It was just too sterile and too large.
Councilor Nell.
Yeah, I think we need to be careful about making too many suggestions for what the Courier writes. I mean, I certainly we would hope that they would give notice about this, and that's fine, and I think we should just perhaps leave it at that.
Yes.
I'm trying to avoid saying something, but my sense is the Portland paper will have a story in before the week is out or the beginning of next week, that part of which will say Cape Elizabeth's been awarded a grant to construct a bikeway on Shore Road. And, you know, the perception at that point is going to be that it's a foregone conclusion. And I think, you know, the word needs to get out that there's still very much a local approval process that needs to occur on this project, and it could very well not occur unless it has an affirmative vote of this town council.
Anybody else? I hear a motion.
I'll give it a shot here. Let's see, I would propose setting a public hearing to authorize the Maine Department of Transportation to begin planning bike pedestrian shoulders on Shore Road from Fort Williams Park to Route 77.
For January?
For
1995?
January 1995.
What would be the date?
January 9.
9?
January 9, thank you.
7:30.
7:30, Town Hall.
7:30 in the town.
Is that in your motion?
Yes, absolutely, thank you.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second it.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody else, wait a minute, anybody out there that's, have any comments one way or the other on this item? You're free to speak. Guess not. So we'll vote on the motion?
No, we won't, not without comments. Comments come after a motion is made.
Excuse me.
Yes, I'm going to vote against this, and I'm going to vote against it for two reasons. One, I cannot see Cape Elizabeth spending $85,000, and secondly, I think, based on the message I got from the events of the past week, I doubt that we want to see the federal government spending $340,000.
Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Nell.
I plan to vote to put this to public hearing. I think there are some issues that the public should have a chance to look at. There are some safety issues on that road, and I think sooner or later, those safety issues need to be addressed. And while nobody, I mean, we don't have an extra $85,000 to spend, we would have some time to look into that, and if we don't do this now, if we don't look into it now, let me phrase it that way, we would definitely miss $300,000 in federal money, which came, certainly a certain amount of that came from Cape Elizabeth in the first place. So I don't want to close the door yet. We may well decide that that is not a priority and that we don't want to spend that money, but I would suggest that we should not close the door on that tonight.
Anybody else? This is kind of my feelings. I'm not fully in favor of the project, but I'm willing to hold a public hearing and get the feelings of the people that one way or the other, as far as the project goes, I don't feel I'm committed myself or council or the residents of Cape Elizabeth to any money at this point. I think there'll be another motion before that takes place. Okay, nobody else? So you ready to vote? All those in favor? Those opposed? One, two, three opposed. Four. Okay, you get that? Item 74, to consider the acceptance of Rock Crest Drive and take any necessary action. I believe you all received a little map earlier this evening. As Stonegate, does the manager have anything he'd like to add to it?
Yes, a couple of things. I'd briefly like to go over the map with you, and in my discussion, I'll be discussing, if you don't object, items 74, 75, and 76 together. Paul Bulger, who is also here as well, representing CMS, the developer of Stonegate 4. As you can see from the map, what you'll be accepting is Rock Crest Drive, which extends off Stonegate Road, part of Stonegate Phase 4. We accepted back a few years ago a small portion of Rock Crest Drive extending up to Greystone Road that was part of Stonegate Phase 3, I believe. This road has been, as long with Quartz Knob Road, which is a small street to the, cuts off to the left, has been built in accordance with town specifications. The council saw this a few years ago when subdivision was before preliminary and final approval, and agreed to accept it at that point, subject to final construction being built according to town standards. In addition to accepting the two roads, you'd also be accepting a number of drainage easements, which are shown on this plan. You'd be accepting a number of parcels to the large parcel in red to the left is parcel A, that you are accepting with a number of conservation restrictions. And it does abut a significant piece of town-owned land that you can see to the, on the left side of the map, particularly an existing trail easement that runs along the back lots on, off Stonegate Road and in Gate Ledge Road, I believe, as well. And then the other acreage at the top left extends all the way to Shore Road. So what this does do is create a continuum of town-owned land under conservation restrictions extending from almost Mitchell Road all the way back to Shore Road, an objective that's been around for about 20 years, and this finally does accomplish it. On the other side, you see parcel B, which is a an additional conservation land. You also see at the top in blue a section of what looks like a road. There's actually no road proposed there. That is simply a pedestrian footpath that folks could walk down and connect to Dyer Pond Road for those that want to go for to walk on a road instead of through the woods, or you know, during wintertime usage, people could go down there and connect with Dyer Pond Road and head right over to Fort Williams. So it really does help to tie the community together. It will be a significant conservation asset to the community, and I would urge that you finally do accept the conservation parcel, the drainage easements, the other rights, and the two roads themselves, utilities therein.
Anybody got a comment one way or the other?
I have a question.
Councilor Dalbert.
The part in blue that connects with Dyer Pond Road, considering our concern, or the town's concerns over the years on dead-end roads, why not connect it?
That issue was debated during the planning process. I had recommended that it be connected, and it was one of many defeats on that issue along the years. And it was a strong feeling of the planning board at the time, and I think the council agreed, that it was important to maintain the safety within this neighborhood, that they didn't want it to become a throughway, a speedway, of people, you know, going through quickly to get from Shore Road up to this point. It was felt for the what was seen as the safety of the neighborhood from a pedestrian biker point of view, as opposed to a vehicle access and egress point of view.
Might that be made accessible to emergency vehicles?
I haven't been on it in about 5 years, but it, if, as I recall it, there's a ledge at one point that's higher than this ceiling. It's really difficult terrain. And Mr. Bulger's here. He lives in the neighborhood as well as representing CMS. He's been there more recently than I, and might be able to be address the issue.
Sounds like a real gift. It's that high.
Mr. McGovern, I think you've fairly characterized the terrain there in that parcel C.
You state your name, please.
I'm sorry. I'm Paul Bulger. I'm general counsel for the developer, CMS, Inc. I just wanted to say, Mr. Chairman, that and to members of the council, that you know, I've had the distinct pleasure of working with a very fine quality developer on this project, and everyone I've been associated with on the project, Maureen O'Meara, Fred Morin, the town's consulting engineer, Bob Malley, virtually everyone who's been involved has done just a terrific job. The compaction tests that were run in that road, for example, required that the developer very carefully lay out that road and properly construct it. And I don't think there's so much as a divot in the road. I could probably land a C-130 transport plane on it. So I think overall, if I had to advocate for acceptance of the road, I'd say that the council can accept the road in the condition that it's in and not lay awake nights as to whether or not you've done the right thing. The road is designed to town standards and will be hopefully easily maintained as such. I personally helped with marking the trails there with the Conservation Commissioners, Jack Roberts and John Green, and they're pretty excited about it. This is the first project where the trails have actually been marked, clearly marked for public use, and I think it's going to be a real asset to the town.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody got a comment? I have a comment, as I didn't quite understand that in blue, the road that the way that hooks on to Diapon Road, is that, you say that's passable now?
That is wooded, and it runs, as you see, it runs between lots 6 and 7. It looks, as it's a paper street, it looks like as if it's a street. It's not at all. It's a very high ledge with trees on top of it. It is a marked trail, however. There's been some chipping that's been done. Some of the trees have been cut very modestly, just so that you can identify the trail, and it's there for as a pedestrian footpath, nothing more at the present time. If in the future the town wanted to improve that way and connect it up with Dyer Pound, it could do that. I don't foresee that happening.
Thank you. Anybody else? Well, I am just concerned that this looks, now I know it's not quite as long, another Shore Acres type deal, that there's one way in, same way out of this road, and I don't think that, I thought that is something that wasn't to be planned for the future of Cape Elizabeth in developments. And someday they might be some different thinking and would want to be able to come across from Shore Road on to Mitchell Road. And also, I have a question for the manager of the on this conservation area that we're accepting. What would that yank off of the tax roll, would you say? Would you have a figure that you would care to guess?
Very little, because it's taxed at a very low value because of its current use is wet, most of it.
So if it's wet and what have you, it still is a good area for a trail, is that?
Portions of parcel A are okay for a trail. Most of it is very wet.
Okay.
It's more for the ducks and the aesthetic enjoyment from the remaining area.
Mr. Chairman, there are a series of trails, old woods trails, that cut through that land already, and it's not extensively used. I think for people that are familiar with the trails are certainly used, but I think over time they'll probably be used more frequently. I've of course walked through there with my family, and my three-year-old was able to manage it. It's very wet in some areas, and in fact half of my parcel, the parcel that my house is built on, is in wetlands, but 10 months out of the year it's dry, as is the nature of wetlands, so for what it's worth.
So where would people park if they wanted to walk those trails?
Well, I suppose that's a very good question. You'd presumably park on Rockcrest Drive or Stonegate Road. The roads aren't really designed for that in particular. There isn't any, the width of the road doesn't allow for a great deal of parking. On the other hand, you could park there without creating a nuisance.
Thank you. Anybody else?
The hope is that people would park either in Fort Williams and walk the entire length, or park come from their homes in the Mitchell Road area and use this system to walk over to Fort Williams area.
Okay. Thank you. I think that takes care of it. As far as any questions, I don't think anyone else here has a question. And so I think taking these items all together, maybe we better take them one at a time. Let's all members have a different opinion on. Go ahead, Councilor McGlaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept Rock Crest Drive, the right-of-way, Rock Crest Drive and utilities therein. You want to do this separately?
Been moved and seconded. Any comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 7-0.
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept Quartz Knob Road, the right-of-way, and all utilities therein.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any comment, one way or the other? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote.
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept the rights-of-way, the drainage easements, and the conservation deed within the Stone Gate for subdivision as presented to us this evening on the recording plat.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any comment?
I just want to be absolutely clear that everyone understands what you're voting for on parcel B, parcel C, excuse me. Mm-hmm. There's, within that parcel, there's a footpath that prohibits motorized vehicles. There's also a 50-foot right-of-way that prohibits motorized vehicles. However, the deed does allow that motorized vehicles would be allowed if a right-of-way for motor vehicle access is constructed and accepted by the town for that purpose. This does still provide some flexibility for the town to go in there at some point, you know, down the road to reach over those rocks and somehow construct a road over that terrain.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Dahlbeck.
Yes, I'll vote in favor of this, but I think, Chairman Jordan, that you raised a very good point, that if we're going to accept for the town parcels for use by people, accepting that without reasonable parking accommodations for people of the town other than the immediate neighbors is not a good use of town funds. The people who are going to use that path are the people who are living there. And, you know, I just think if we're accepting something for the town that we ought to be thinking that other people might want to enjoy it. That's in the future. You can't put that in a development of this nature now. Don't ask me exactly how you would put it, but it's a thought.
Thank you. Councilor McLaughlin.
I agree with Councilor Dahlbeck to a certain extent. However, this is an important part of the proposed greenbelt for the entire town. And I think, in light of that I'm not particularly concerned with the parking constraints right now. I can find ways from my house to get here, leaving my own car in my own driveway without trespassing.
Well, we've just had another issue at another end of town about somebody being concerned about people parking in front of their property, and I just think it's something we ought to be aware of.
Thank you. Any other comment? Everybody ready for the motion? If so, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote, 7-0. Item 77, to consider authorizing the effective December 5th, 1994, a change in the town hall hours and take any necessary action. I believe you all got a copy of the changes. Would you care to read them, or you would just?
Yeah, I'll briefly highlight them. This came about as a result of the request of the town council to look at town office hours. There was a sense that we ought to be open additional times. What we've done is sent out a whole lot of customer service surveys. Interestingly enough, most people, almost everyone, seems to be extremely happy with the personnel. They get the highest marks in every category with every question. This hasn't been really identified through that process as that big an issue, the hours. Nonetheless, I certainly understand, you know, it's pretty obvious from people that are sometimes waiting out here at 7:45 in the morning that they'd like a chance to get in here earlier get their business done before they go into work. So therefore, I worked very closely with Deborah Lane, with the entire staff. We had a sort of a retreat one night at my home that we discussed this and all sorts of other issues, but we tried to work together to figure out what hours would best serve the public's needs and at the same time address everyone else's concerns along the way. And what we came up with was a proposal that we would open each and every morning at 7:30 instead of at 8, which would help all those folks who have to be to work at 8 and 8:30 to come in and get some of their business done before they go to work. And then we would close each day at 4 o'clock. However, on Monday, we would remain open until 5 o'clock for those who are concerned about that they need, you know, teachers and other folks who have to be to work early and want some later time. So the proposed hours are Monday from 7:30 to 5 and Tuesday through Friday from 7:30 to 4. We did discuss this briefly with the town council in an earlier workshop and understood your concurrence to it. We are sending a letter out to everyone in town informing them of the hours as well as at the same time the new rules for the refuse disposal area. We've also ordered refrigerator magnets that give the hours of the town hall, the refuse disposal area, and the library, along with the phone numbers that we hope people will put on their refrigerators and be reminded of the hours. They're business card size. Barbara got another number of estimates, and I think they're 14 cents apiece. So we hope everyone uses them and considers putting them on their refrigerator and being reminded of the hours.
Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody get a comment one way or the other? Do we hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we establish the new town hall hours.
Second.
Presented.
Seconded.
And moved and seconded. All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, vote 7-0. The next item is citizen discussions of item not on the agenda. We have a citizen out here. You have a any comments?
Much.
You wait through the meeting. And
chance to be a TV star.
That's right. Hearing none, we'll move on. Someone want to make a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? Adjourn.
Good job.